Thank you very much. So what I would like to share with you is our experience with a launcher using commercial devices, and particularly automotive devices. So the work is based on the experience got by Thales Alenia Space in Belgium and in Spain, and some experience of Thales Alenia Space Toulouse in Constellation as Iridium Nest. So the first question, the agenda is why automotive for launchers, some figures of what is used in launchers, the suppliers, how to purchase, traceability, counterfeit, control of PCM and PDM, obsolescence, last standby, the feedback from the manufacturers, the incoming results, the construction analysis, the ROS and the reach, and the conclusions. So, with some figures, Thales Alenia Space Belgium have four equipments, Spain has one equipment. In total, we speak about 600 components, and in total, we have 67 components in automotive levels. And if we add the components in plastic enhanced devices according to a vendor item drawing, the total amount is 70%. Some components are procured in hermetic package in military level, and the rest are pure commercial components from other sources. The procurement, taking into account the amount of quantities we have to procure, is typically done through authorized distributors and sometimes directly through the manufacturer. Distributors like DGK, Mauser, Farnell, Arrow, Arnet, and so on. We prefer to define for the project two or three preferred distributors and try to share with the distributor our complete list for the procurement in order the distributor help us for the tracking of the PCM-PDM. PCM-PDM is the most critical issue when procuring commercial devices, even automotive parts. So, first to clarify with distributor, which is not easy, our needs, traceability, lot the code, assembly lot, wafer lot. Even for automotive devices, some distributors are not able to provide this information, and we have to go directly to the manufacturer to clarify according to the marking on the reel, on the marking on the components, what is the information we have got. We try to get recent lots, young lots, no more than 1 year old lots. This is always not always possible. Of course, single lot, and a lot of homogeneity in terms of assembly lot and wafer lot. Always, not always possible. An appropriate packaging for the delivery of the parts. We cannot accept alternatives for non-AEC devices, non-automotive, which is the typical approach of some distributor to say, you have this I don't have a stock of this component, but I have this other one, which is not the automotive you would like. So this is not acceptable. And you have to implement a counterfeit control plan, including authentication controls, like, of course, data review, visual inspection, physical scope, construction analysis, and DPA. Problem with suppliers. Many problems with lead times. Even if you consider that commercial or automotive are available off the shelf, the reality is that most of them are not off the shelf. They are not in stock. So, particularly the last three years, due to the mobile consumer market, the lead times were very problematic for resistor and capacitors. Due to this, we recommend to select two or three sources for each device. Difficulties when requiring a single lot traceability for some distributors. In some cases, the minimum buys were prohibitive for the procurement. And also a surprise was the export license for many plastic enhancer devices, export license like some automotive parts. So some ECCA, 3A, 5A, and 3A991. So the follow-up of the PCMPDM is one of the most critical issues and implies a huge amount of work. If you have a PCM, it's like has been said this morning, it's like an obsolescence. The component, if changed anything, a priori, could be a new component. A new component in terms of die, so revision, a new component in terms of assembly, so has stress and mounting capability at lower level, or even if the plastic molding material change, the CTE, the glass transition temperature change, you have to restart from zero with this component. So the follow-up of the PCA is critical. And in case of you have to contact the manufacturer to check for any new lot by construction analysis and by glass transition temperature measurements. Obsolescence and last standby is also critical. In only 2 years, for a list and a small list of devices for Ariane, we have faced 3 last standbys. Some of them are will last standbys. It means obsolescence with no time to place orders. So it's really critical. 4 devices for which we expected our calculation was an end of life not before 2023. The feedback from the manufacturer, we have all, from the very good to the very bad, for commercial and for automotive. Some manufacturers are able to provide the production pass approval process free of charge and many reliability reports, and others ask for payment as to quote this data. So some manufacturers ask for a quotation for some reliability data. From the very bad, no answer at all, to the very good. So willing to provide all the information on the component. And this is for both, for automotive and for commercial, pure commercial. There are many data in the database, in the website, but some data important for the application, even information like the material declaration of the component, which is critical for our qualification of the component on board level, sometimes is not provided. And ESD, something as ESD is not always listed, reported in the data sheet or in the web. So recommended, establish the yearly communication channel with manufacturer and work preferably with manufacturer with better support. What we have found is that some manufacturers have a very good reliability data and others provide reliability data which is more than 10 years, more than 10 years age. Well, the incoming inspection for automotive devices, we have to say that we have not found any failure or any anomaly, any contradiction between what we received and what is reported in the datasheet in terms of visual dimensions or materials. We have found some anomalies, but on non-automotive devices. The visual inspection criteria has to be changed because what is written in the ESCC or MIL standard is not appropriate for most of plastic. We propose AIADEC JES 22B101 is much better in our point of view for this incoming inspection. Construction analysis. In total, we have done something like 200 construction analysis or DPA. This was done according to the ECSS standard. Even some commercial, not all commercial, are plastic without cavity. There are some RF parts with cavity, which are almost hermetic but not hermetic. We have to do pin test as a part of the incoming, and we find failures in pin test. The ratio is not very high, but we find failures. And we have to do seal test, but this test, our experience that has not added value on this kind of components, because the information you have is a yearly leak test, but not long-term leak test, because all the adhesives with time, you have permeability of moisture. And we have not found many anomalies on DPA and construction analysis apart of the laminations, and most of the all devices in Ariane has to be rough and rich, so have to be of course lead is forbidden for Ariane, and all devices, many devices we have found as rough in the data sheet. In fact, inside the construction, we found high temperature melting solders like tin lead, which is not rust. So for the delaminations, most of the lamination, the feedback from the manufacturer is that this lamination are cosmetic and should be acceptable according to the standard JEDEC-STD 020, and if we are able to do what is instructed by the 020. So the initials, electricals, visual, acoustic, conditioning, and final electricals. And if the delamination is not broken, it is acceptable. This is some tests which are in progress at Travis Speed. So this is some kinds of delamination. And for the rocks and the ridge, we have fine and well some several components with high temperature solders, which are allowed by the ROS directive by the sections 7A or 7D. So, conclusions. When we speak about automotive devices and our experience in Ariane and Vega launchers, is that in the construction analysis or the incoming test we have performed, including pin test, Fisher scope and visual inspection, is that no anomalies. The added value of the incoming visual is very low. The construction analysis is a very high added value task, particularly when you would like to compare lot by lot in terms of any differences in for assembly, materials, CTE, glass transition temperatures, because don't forget, presently, the standard is that every batch has the similarity for commercial is not allowed by the ECSS QST7038, and you have to qualify every batch to mounting qualification, unless you are able to demonstrate that no change at all are from one lot to the next one. And the only way to demonstrate this is by a close follow-up of the manufacturer, information on construction analysis and information on CTE, glass transition temperature and materials of the construction. The recommendation is that the follow-up of the PCMPDM is critical, and this is a huge amount of work. And the increased attrition policy and recommended inner storage, even if most of the parts are classified as moisture sensitivity level 1.
Thank you very much, Luis. We have time for a few questions.
Oof.
So, 1, 2, 3.
So, you said it's collecting the data from the suppliers, for some of them very helpful or easy, for others it's very difficult. Can you give an average, let's say, estimation in hours or whatever, how much it took you to, for each line item, to collect all these data, to get all your data together, or is that not so easy to say?
I prefer not to give details of what manufacturer went bad.
No, no, but just to get an understanding what the average amount of hours per item you have spent
the
on.
The summary is that the information, to collect the information is a must. So you have to get the information. You cannot live without the information. So you have to insist to the manufacturer, to the distributor, or whatever way you have to get the information on materials, on ESD,
or real ability and whatever you need for your application. Because things like derating is very close to the reliability information from the manufacturer. Even for a launcher application, which only 8 hours needed. So it's a must.
Hello. Very interesting content, thank you. Let's say you have a very high volume requirement and you're not able to get a single lot, so you would probably get or try to get successive lots. Would you perform a construction analysis / DPA on every lot, or you would use the DPA you've performed on the previous lot and try to just do it by similarity?
The requirement from Maria is construction analysis on first lot and then no construction analysis or DPA unless, which is not abnormal, you have any doubt of any modification of the new lot in respect to the previous one in terms of manufacturing materials and so on. So, up to now, our policy has been first lot construction analysis, next lot DPA. Particularly when we perform heavy iron tests, because any modification in the die is could affect, of course, the single benefit performances.
And what's your typical sample size for the constructional analysis?
For the construction analysis, typically, as requested by ECSS, is 5 pieces.
Okay.
The most important is the cross section of the die, of the molding, of the lead frame, of the wires, because it's the only way to then to understand the delamination. Delamination is something that you will see very, very common. Some are very small, in the order of less than 1 micrometer. Even I have seen 300 nanometers, but it's not the same a delamination just on the bonding of a wire that a delamination over a die which is coated by a protective layer. Of course, it's not the same at all. So, delamination, you will see always delamination, you have to interpret the risk of delamination, you need support from the manufacturer.
Last question.
Yes, hello, Luis. Just a question about the counterfeit. You mentioned the construction analysis as a pertinent to prevent counterfeit. Does it mean you procure parts from non-franchise distributor?
Never. It's forbidden at that group.
So if you procure, why you mention the construction analysis as important to prevent counterfeit, if you procure the parts from the franchise distributor, you have no risk? Or do you have evidence of counterfeit part with franchise?
I have not experienced any counterfeit, but I have heard so many counterfeit, even with authorized distributors, that I think I should recommend now. I don't know if in 1 year on I will change opinion, but now I will recommend to authenticate the parts by means of visual Fisher scope, because the Fisher scope will give you exactly the composition of either the NP or the team, because sometimes they say SAC 305 and then it's not SAC 305, and the construction analysis is the only way to be sure. But I have not experienced counterfeit. But the list of counterfeit to Richard Webb is even with ITAR. If there are people able to do copies of ITAR, so all is possible.
Thank you. I think that you have a lot of to exchange between the two primes. Thank you very much, Luis.